Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to another session in the certificate program in practice-based research methods. Today's session is titled Translational Research and Its Relevance to Practice-Based Research Networks. As always, this training series is facilitated by the Clinical Directors Network. This gives you live access to the live access and recorded access to all archived videos. It is also in part facilitated by the N-Squared, which is a virtual training series funded by the AHRQ. The certificate program is brought to you by eight PBRN centers of excellence, and is facilitated by Dr. James Werner. As always, please make sure that your audio is working properly in the audio setup. That is, if you are not using the telephone line. If you are using telephone conference, please make sure that your phone is muted. If you have any questions or any concerns, double-click on CDN, double-click on Clinical Directors Network, and I will help with any technical issues. And any questions that you have, you may put into the chat box. At this time, I'm going to pass it over to Dr. James Werner, who will introduce our speakers today.
Thank you, Vladimir. Welcome to our fellows, mentors, and anyone else who may be joining us today for this webinar. It's my great pleasure to introduce our speakers, Dr. Steve Woolf and Jonathan Tobin. I'll introduce Dr. Woolf first. Stephen Woolf, MD, MPH, is director of the Virginia Commonwealth University Center on Society and Health, and he's professor of family medicine and population health at Virginia Commonwealth University. He's board certified in family medicine and preventive medicine and public health. Dr. Woolf has published more than 170 articles in a career that has focused on promoting the most effective healthcare services and on advocating the importance of health promotion and disease prevention, and the need to address the social determinants of health. In addition to scientific publications, Dr. Woolf has emphasized outreach to policymakers, the public, and the media to raise awareness about factors outside of healthcare that shape health outcomes. Dr. Woolf was elected to the Institute of Medicine in 2001, so thank you for being with us today, Dr. Woolf. Dr. Jonathan Tobin is presenting with Dr. Woolf, and Dr. Tobin is president and CEO of the Clinical Directors Network, CDN, a New York City-based practice-based research network dedicated to improving clinical and patient-centered outcomes for the underserved by creating community and academic partnerships. Dr. Tobin is professor in the Department of Epi and Population Health at Albert Einstein College of Medicine, and he's co-director for community-engaged research at the Rockefeller University. He serves as a PI and co-PI on grants from ARC, the CORI, NIMH, NHLBI, NCATS, and other NIH institutes and federal agencies in studies of behavior stress, cardiovascular disease, cancer, HIV and AIDS, and other health problems, all designed to translate research into practice. He also directs a web-based training institute that's produced more than 900 CME-accredited courses. We appreciate Dr. Tobin and the Clinical Directors Network hosting all of the webinars for the PBRN Method Certificate Program. So just as a reminder to our fellows and mentors, if you would like to ask a question during the presentation, please use the chat box in the lower left part of your screen and type in your question. And we'll get to your question as quickly as we can. And please remember to mute your phones if you're not speaking. So Dr. Woolf and Dr. Tobin, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Werner. This is Steve Woolf, and I am really pleased to be able to do this presentation along with Dr. Tobin. I encourage an interactive process, so feel free to jump in if you have questions, and I'll hopefully get some assistance with the technology so that I know when a hand has been raised. But definitely, please step in if you want more clarification. We do have a lot of material to cover, so I want to forewarn you that the slides are going to be moving relatively quickly. But I guess the advantage of it being recorded is you can go back and review the material again. So today we're talking about translational research and its relevance to PBRNs. And my interest in this topic has always been at the core issue of what we even mean by the term translational research. It's something we hear about a lot. It's something that gained a lot of prominence through the CTSA program, but you find that foundations and industry talk a lot about translational research, have centers for translational research. Disease-related organizations like the American Heart Association and others have formed divisions around translational research. Hospitals and health systems have this. There are now journals that are titled translational research, and yet the meaning of the term is a little bit amorphous. It actually has a long history, and there is a traditional view of translational research that's historically been very rooted at the NIH that views the translation of findings from basic science and discoveries from bench research into actionable treatments as the domain of translational research. This is often called the bench to bedside continuum. And this is what many people think of when they talk about translational research, is getting to the point where you have medications, surgical treatments, or other interventions able to be offered to patients. And translational research is the journey from basic science to that point. So the classic definition, this is an example from JAMA, speaks of the translation of new knowledge and so forth into new approaches for prevention, diagnosis, and treatment. And the image of where this kind of research occurs is pretty much the laboratory. And this is certainly what academic health centers and pharmaceutical laboratories and other settings think of when they envision translational research. But older people like myself remember a different notion around translational research. So if you go back to the year 2000 and even before that, there was talk about translating research into practice, an initiative reflected in this fact sheet that ARC launched back then had the unfortunate acronym TRIP, but was basically talking about how do we get the findings of research translated into practice. So for many of us in primary care, in health services research, translational research is about the continuum of getting evidence into practice, something that notably takes many years. And there's many examples of evidence-based findings that have taken a long period of time, some estimates as long as 17 years, to become implemented in routine practice. And so the work area for this kind of translational research involves things like improving access to care, reorganizing and coordinating systems of care, system redesign, if you will, helping clinicians and patients to change their behaviors and make more informed choices, reminder systems, improving the clinician-patient relationship. All of these and other examples that could go on this slide are in the sphere of translating research into practice. And that's what other people have in mind when they talk about translational research. So if you will, the first notion of translational research is how do you get these pills made? Whereas the second one is thinking about the patient whose bottle of pills is sitting on the shelf not being taken. She's not sure whether she should take the medicine or whether she can afford the medicine. She's on the phone trying to work out insurance coverage or receive instructions from the physician about whether the medicine should be taken. That's the second domain of translational research. How do you get the benefits of that bottle of pills translated into improved health outcomes for this patient? We don't do a good job of this in our country. This is a classic study that came out over 10 years ago by Beth McGlynn and her colleagues at RAND, showing that Americans only get about half of the recommended health services they should be receiving. So that gap in the quality of care, what was originally highlighted in the quality CASP report by the IOM at the turn of the century, remains a central problem and much of the focus of the second kind of translational research. And yet, we live in an environment where basic science advances are the sexy thing, and so much of the resources that are going to translational research are more in this space. And so the improvement in care that is often necessary to bring the benefits of those medications and other treatments to patients is often lost in translation. One concept to be familiar with that illustrates the difference between these two notions of translational research is this old diagram from a 2002 JAMA article that was the result of a lot of work that had gone into rethinking the research enterprise at NIH. And what this diagram shows you is the journey that we go through in clinical research from basic biomedical research to improved health. And what you can see here is T1, as it's called, the first stage of translational research, is that bench-to-bedside effort of taking the results of basic science and getting them to a point where we have actionable treatment. Whereas T2 is the second kind of notion of translating that knowledge into actually best practices in healthcare and improved decision making. Other people have added more T's to the list. There's T1, T2, T3, T4. This was an early example that came out from these faculty in the family medicine field, unpacking T2 into components of developing guidelines, meta-analyses, and systematic reviews based on results of multiple studies, practice-based research where that provides an environment for testing the feasibility of implementation strategies, and then T3, the dissemination and implementation of those findings in broader, more scalable settings. But if you read up on this literature, you'll find many more acronyms and T4s, T5s, and T6s, but I'm not going to confuse you with all of those just to let you know that they exist. So the distinction between these two reflected here, I think this has been clarified. But I want to talk about how different these are, that translational research in these two different contexts, T1 and T2, is alike in name only. They have different goals. They occur in different settings. The types of study designs that you would consider for doing this kind of research are different. And the kinds of investigators that get involved with this kind of research are often very different. So, for example, the laboratory of T1 typically occurs at academic health centers or major science laboratories, either at the bedside or in the operating room or in laboratories and so forth, whereas the laboratory of T2 is out on the front lines where care is actually delivered. It's a bit of a messier setting, but it's actually one that reaches a larger proportion of the population. The kind of resources that you need if you're involved with T1 research, obviously, a mastery of the basic sciences, molecular biology, genetics, nanotechnology, and so forth. You need clinical scientists who are properly trained to do this kind of research. You need strong, well-resourced laboratories for doing it, cutting-edge technology, an infrastructure that's supportive within the institution. And those of you who are connected with CTSA programs will recognize that this is largely the focus of the CTSA effort, is to build up the capacity to provide these five bullets at leading centers of research. And that is one research. Is somebody trying to ask a question? Yeah? Okay, I'll move on. This kind of activity is very popular in the public mindset. When Americans think about research advances, they are looking for breakthroughs in medication, treatments, application of technology. So this category of translational research is very well resourced and very well very popular with the public, the policymakers, and the people who fund research. Whereas the second kind of research occurs in more humble-looking laboratories like this one, which is a family practice in a rural area of my state. But although this is a rather unattractive and simple-looking laboratory, it actually is the one that reaches a larger proportion of the U.S. population. Some of you may be familiar with this diagram. If you're not, you probably should. As a matter of medical history, this is the original diagram that Carr White published in the 1960s. And basically what it's showing is if you take a hypothetical population of 1,000 people, the proportion of them who will have symptoms, only about 300 or so will consider seeking medical care. Only 21 of those will visit an outpatient clinic. Only 13 will go to an emergency department. And eight will be hospitalized, and less than one will be hospitalized in an academic medical center. So part of his point was that if you read the New England Journal and most of the other major journals, where most of the research that's being published is coming out of this academic medical center environment, you're talking about interventions that have been tested in a very small subset of the general population. And certainly when it comes to actually translating research into practice, the places where most Americans receive their care, practice-based research that occurs in this larger outpatient setting actually has more exposure to the population at risk. And so research that occurs in that environment involves a different kind of scientific toolkit, what many people call implementation science. And the kinds of domains that enter into that kind of work include clinical epidemiology, communication theory, behavioral science, public policy issues, especially in this day and age with healthcare reform, financing issues, organizational theory, much of it coming from the business world, system redesign, informatics and information technology, electronic medical records, and mixed methods and qualitative research. These and other examples are the kind of work that goes into this kind of translational research, a different kind of expertise than what is required for laboratory science. And so the challenges facing these two forms of research look a little different. On the T1 side, conquering biological and technological mysteries poses a real challenge. So does trial recruitment, regulatory concerns, and so forth. Whereas in T2 research, a lot of the challenges have to do with dealing with the messiness of human behavior, organizational inertia, whether you have infrastructure and resources for doing this kind of research, and from a methodological standpoint, how you deal with the messiness of conditions that keep changing as you're going along and trying to rebuild an airplane while it's flying makes this kind of research design even more challenging. In many academic health centers, when people think about that, you know, humble-looking practice out in rural Virginia, there is a tendency here in the Mecca to view those clinicians and those practices as mainly a pool for potentially recruiting trial subjects for the studies that take place at the academic health center. That's sort of the old-fashioned way of thinking about it, but increasingly, we view these two settings as having a bidirectional collaborative relationship where the academic health center is important in formulating research questions, but really must go out to the community setting to obtain generalizable populations that are more typical of the patients who will be receiving the treatment. So the efficacy may be demonstrated at the academic health center in a randomized controlled trial that ends up in the New England Journal, but this setting becomes important for evaluations of effectiveness and also for evaluating systems for delivering these interventions in a more generalizable way that's scalable across the country. So there is ideally a partnership between these two forms of research that ultimately becomes important in improving the quality of care. Dr. Tobin's going to take over now for a few minutes and give you some more practical examples of how this plays out in a practice-based research network environment, and then I'm going to have some closing comments after he finishes. Jonathan?
Thank you, Dr. Woolf. Thank you, Dr. Werner. I'm really excited about the opportunity to share with you today some thoughts about the translational research process. And to do that, I wanted to focus on a specific case of translational research that Clinical Directors Network and I have been involved with for quite a number of years. And so what I'd like to do is just to give you very briefly the background. CDN is a primary care practice-based research network that works with the healthcare safety net, mostly federally qualified health centers, but other types of primary care practices as well. And CDN's primary activity is building a research infrastructure or deploying a research infrastructure across health centers in order to build a learning healthcare system. And as part of that activity, we have been fortunate to have a P30 grant support through AHRQ, and we refer to our N-squared PBRN, the Network of Networks, which is our network of safety net practice-based research networks. And we have a tremendous collaboration across the United States with a number of very exciting networks of very exciting PBRNs. And this entire fellowship program is a collaboration across the AHRQ P30 networks of networks. So I suppose we could call this the N-cubed network. But to move into the remarks that I'm going to share this morning, PBRNs conduct a wide range of different types of research, including descriptive studies, observational studies, and the examples that I'm going to focus in on this morning are experimental studies, in particular randomized controlled trials or RCTs. We also will touch on dissemination and implementation research and quality improvement, all within that same parameter. And the framework, as Dr. Woolf mentioned, that the implementation science really contributes very significantly to our designs of experimental studies and observational studies. And I would recommend people take a look at this paper by Proctor to look at the framework that they've proposed that examines implementation outcomes, service outcomes, and health outcomes. And so I think that's a convenient way of thinking of the different categories of evaluation that one could do, and ideally a well-designed study would demonstrate impact across implementation, service, and health outcomes when conducted in a practice-based setting. So on to the project at hand, and the backdrop here is the good news, bad news. We can see here some declines in the incidence in mortality rates of colorectal cancer by race and ethnicity over the last quarter of a century or so. But those declines are not uniform across gender and certainly not across ethnicity. More closely to home, CDN is located in New York City, and although we work with many practices in different states and territories, the data that I'm going to share right now comes from a sequence of studies all conducted in New York City and the surrounding communities of Westchester and New Jersey. But if we look at the colonoscopy screening rate, so colon cancer is highly detectable when and highly treatable when detected early, and colonoscopy is one, not the only, but one of the U.S. Preventive Service Task Force recommended approaches to colon cancer screening. And we can see that in New York City at the turn of 2010, private insured patients had a 73% percentage completion rate of colonoscopy, but that rate drops down substantially to 60% for patients with public insurance through Medicaid and to 43% for patients who are uninsured. And of course, the patients that we see typically in community health centers come largely from Medicaid and from the uninsured, and so that indicates the significant location of the disparity. So to that end, we undertook a series of NCI-funded randomized clinical trials that examined our ability in federally qualified health centers initially and then with Medicaid managed care organizations to examine the potential benefit of deploying prevention care management, prevention care managers, to help people complete their screening for breast, cervical, and colorectal cancer For the purposes of this conversation, I'm going to focus on the colorectal cancer screening outcomes since they are the most challenging ones. And so what I'll share are some information on the transition of studies from our initial efficacy study to an effectiveness study to dissemination and implementation, and then I'll comment finally briefly on scale-up and mention also in passing the current study where we've now moved to look at subgroups of the population that may not be benefiting from prevention care management alone. So if we look at the work over the last 15 years or so, our original study of efficacy took place in federally qualified health centers, and the components across our studies referred to as PCM1, PCMT, PCM2, and now we're currently involved in the PCM3 trial, involved developing and deploying scripts for prevention care managers. These were typically bachelor's level staff at the health educators who were trained with scripts in English and Spanish to facilitate identification of barriers and help patients overcome those barriers. The system also involved clinician reminders that were mailed to the patient, personalized letters, activation cards mailed, education on test-specific materials sent to the patients in advance. We confirmed from the electronic health records their absence of screening data and then confirmed by telephone that they, in fact, were in need of those preventive services, and we assisted with scheduling the appointments, providing telephone reminder calls, and sending out reminder letters. So because time is short, I'm going to give you a synopsis of all of the findings from our three studies. So the PCM1 study, it gave us the opportunity to look at the effect in community health centers, and we had an 84% increase, relative risk of 1.84. So we determined that this intervention was highly significant in the community health center population. We then undertook a second study working with a Medicaid managed care organization focusing on the Medicaid patients to see whether instead of our staff doing the intervention and deploying the scripts from CDN's office, could we in fact train the care managers to do telephone support from the managed care organization, thinking that that might be a more sustainable approach. And in fact, as you see here, we had an effect size of 1.43. And then on the basis of that study with a single Medicaid managed care organization in the Bronx and the Westchester in New York City metropolitan area, we conducted a third clinical trial with three additional large Medicaid managed care organizations, and our effect size there was 1.3. So when I saw this original result, I subtitled the analysis Lost in Translation, harking back to Dr. Woolf's picture of Bill Murray in Japan, because by my eyeballing this, it looked to me like we had an inverse dose response, and as you move from efficacy when the work is being done by the research, by external practice facilitators, you get the best results, and then when you scale it up, you get less results. However, when you look at the overall effect size across these three independent randomized clinical trials, it gives you an overall effect size of 1.5, so there was a 50% improvement. And when we look at the I-square, which is a measure of heterogeneity and the p-value associated with that, the interpretation that I understand from meta-analysis suggests that these three independent estimates of effect do not differ significantly from each other, so that this overall effect size is said to be homogeneous, not said to be different, so we can reject the hypothesis that something was lost in translation. But in fact, in trying to explain why there appeared to be a diminution, we noticed that in the transition from PCM1 to PCM2, that the proportion of English speakers actually was different. And when we looked at stratum-specific effects, we noted that the effect size was significantly higher among Spanish speakers in both the first trial and in the second trial, as compared to English speakers, and those differences were both statistically significant. So we did observe some significant heterogeneity of that treatment effect. That's illustrated here. The blue line is our first trial set in community health centers, including uninsured and insured patients. The second trial here in red, set in Medicaid managed care organizations, had a lower proportion of Spanish-speaking patients, and so the overall effect did appear to diminish. But we learned a very important message from this, that in fact the heterogeneity of treatment effects is very real and very important to be mindful, and in a medically underserved population, we do need to consider whether there are different population subgroups that may have different experiences with the intervention and with the outcomes. And that's, I think, so well illustrated by all of these differences in the Spanish versus English effects here. So when we think about scale-up of this, is going from implementation, dissemination to implementation to scale-up, in New York City, we can conclude from this series of studies that this wide range of different practice settings, primary care clinicians and health centers, hospital diagnostic and treatment centers, and Medicaid managed care organizations would benefit from this care management intervention, that this strategy works across a wide range of settings and can be adapted into QI initiatives. And now the question that we're examining as part of our current PCM3 study is really trying to understand more granularly the patient subgroups that may benefit more or less from this type of intervention, since we already demonstrated that language was an important determinant. But I want to share an independent assessment of the implementation of our prevention care management strategy. This is not work that we've done, but this is work that the New York City Department of Health and Mental Hygiene implementing a patient navigation program using some of the same approaches and scripts in the same time interval had statistically significantly beneficial increases both in terms of patients who are insured with Medicaid and patients who are uninsured using this. So I think this is an apt demonstration of the capacity of taking research, which we began in around the year 2000. And so for better or for worse, that 15-year, 17-year cycle seems to have applied here. But we're happy to see that these benefits are now accruing to the most vulnerable population in New York City. And we have great hopes for the sustainability and reach of this. And in fact, the other exciting piece of information to come out of this work at the New York City Health Department, when you look at the health survey, is the reduction in the differences among some of the ethnic groups. There's still a disparity for Asian and Pacific Islanders, so we know that language and culture play a very important role here, but we're encouraged by the reduction in the disparity that we saw in 2003. So I'll just conclude by acknowledging the many health centers in New York City that have been part of this this important journey, and mention that this really has been what I think the Grateful Dead were the best at conveying as a long, strange trip. So with that,
Dr. Tobin, we have a question from Tamer Saeed in the chat box.
Okay.
Dr. Saeed is asking, how can we conclude that the intervention worked equally well in different groups given different languages?
So thank you for that question. And again, to go back to the heterogeneity analysis, we actually see in the slide that I put up, I went through this rather quickly, that in PCM1, the effect size for English speakers was 1.4, and that was significantly different and, in fact, diminished. The Spanish language patients had an effect size of 1.9, and then similarly in the second trial conducted purely in the managed care setting, effect size was 1.13. for the English language speakers, 1.81 for the Spanish language speakers. So we did not conduct this trial in languages other than English and Spanish. We know that New York is a multilingual, multicultural place, and we did develop a Russian language version of the program as well. Time didn't permit me to share the data on that, but language certainly does moderate effect in these types of interventions.
That's a really fascinating group of studies. I would imagine that the implementation of those projects was pretty challenging, and I wonder if you could just comment on implementation challenges that you that might have been faced during the process of doing those projects.
Sure, thank you. So it's all in the implementation. It's getting it to the last mile, or in the case of New York, the last block of each person's home. So we think about translation as not only from bench to bedside, but from bench to bedroom, because most of the work in primary care really takes place outside of the office setting and in people's homes. So the challenges were myriad, and again, time didn't permit going into this, but I think the facilitators of this kind of intervention are having great manuals using technology like web-based training, webcasts such as we're doing today, and using electronic health records capabilities for both generating lists of patients who are not up to date, and then using the hard work of the call centers or the patient navigators to reach out to people and try to bring them into practices. Implementation science is not new, although it's newly named as implementation science, but really the places that we have to learn a lot more are, what are the setting variables? So I shared with you language variables, patient characteristics, but we've also observed in other previous studies that the size of the practice makes a big difference, and implementation may often be easier in a smaller practice. We've seen some differences in implementation between practice models, whether it's family medicine or internal medicine multi-specialty, and we've seen differences as to whether they're freestanding or co-located with other specialty services like mental health and other internal medicine subspecialties. So we could spend weeks talking about the implementation, and I gave you the cleaned version, but it really takes a health center, takes a community to get to these kinds of results.
Indeed. Thank you very much.
So to wrap up, let me just make some closing remarks. I think if I were to give you $1 million and ask you whether you wanted to spend it on imaging technology, say to develop a better colonoscope, or to spend it on the kind of research that you just heard about from Dr. Tobin, both are important. One would fall into the category of T1, to develop better technology from basic science research. The second works on not innovating or making incremental improvements in the technology, but doing a better job of getting that care into these populations at risk. And studies that we've done and others have shown that you actually get more bang for the buck in terms of proving health outcomes through the T2 research. It's not an either or, we need to do both, but clearly the T2 research is hugely important to actually move the needle on health outcomes. And yet, when we look at how we spend our research dollars in this country, there is a very disproportionate emphasis on T1. So this is an older slide, but the relationships are largely intact, that most of our R&D money is going into big pharma and the development of new drugs and technologies. A large proportion of the NIH budget, as I'll show you in a minute, is also going to basic science research. And our agency that's responsible for health services research and the kind of work we're talking about is that little bump over there on the right in terms of relative priority. If you look at federal spending, this is as of a year ago in the JAMA article by Moses et al., all biomedical research on the left and the subset that's going toward health services research to the right. That said, as Dr. Tobin mentioned, this is a field that's still dividing itself, even its name. Implementation science is one of the bullets up there, but also on this screen are other names that typically are given to this kind of work. So there is still some identity crisis as well as resource issues in terms of training investigators in doing this kind of work. This program that you're hearing this presentation on is a wonderful example of attempts to address that need. But the other point I want to leave you with is to really broaden our horizons in thinking about the setting where translational research occurs, this kind of T2 research. We come from a medical background. There is a tendency to think in terms of where T2 research falls in relation to personal care. But if you take a broader perspective and think about all the different settings where the work of basic research becomes important in improving health outcomes, then we realize that the implementation of basic science is also happening at the home, the point Dr. Tobin just made about bench to bedroom. Some of it is applied in schools or work sites. Some of it is information that parents need to implement. Some of it's something that industry and device manufacturers take into account. But all of these kinds of implementation become important if the larger goal is not about healthcare, but about improving health. And if that's true, then the practitioners who apply evidence are not just doctors and hospitals, but all of these other stakeholders, patients and the public, public health administrators, employers, and so forth. And if that's true, then the science that goes into translational research broadens beyond the typical domains that we think about in terms of biomedical science and technology to include these other disciplines that you see on the slide. They then become part of the interdisciplinary web of information that actually needs to be incorporated into effective translational research to improve health outcomes. So my hope would be that the future of T2 research in your careers will harness some of the knowledge from these other fields to be more effective in actually improving health outcomes. So what does this what does T2 need? Well, we need a better name. T1 and T2 is a shorthand, but it does tend to create a severe amount of confusion. But we really need to give greater recognition and emphasis to this kind of work. Clearly needs to be more funding going toward it. And that means that policymakers, elected officials, the folks on Capitol Hill that allocate dollars to Congress and so forth, need to understand the distinction between inventing treatments and getting them used, because those are two different things. And a lot of money is going into the invention part and not enough going into getting them used. And as a result of that, the huge investment that goes into T1 research is not fully realized, because if those bottle of pills just stays on the shelf, that all the millions of dollars that went into the R&D of developing that drug is not achieving any meaningful health benefit. And so my final slide is to simply say with this analogy that investing only in T1 would be the equivalent of backing up a truck to the back of this auditorium and unloading a bunch of instruments. The bench-to-bedside continuum that basically delivers a bottle of pills or a new colonoscope doesn't produce the music of improved health. The way we get the music of improved health is taking those instruments and actually orchestrating a team-based approach that's integrated and coordinated to improve health outcomes, just as the conductor uses the talents of the musicians and their instruments to perform beautiful music. So with that, I think I'd like to stop so that we have time for dialogue and conversation, but I hope you found this introduction helpful.
Great. Thank you so much, Dr. Woolf, Dr. Tobin. I have a question just to get us started, and this may be a bit of a naive question, but what steps do you suggest that PBRNs and people who are working in translational research can take to help move the needle towards doing research that actually allows bench-generated discoveries to be translated into practice, to change those priorities for the decision makers and policy makers? what would be perhaps a first step that we could take?
Well, I'll let Dr. Tobin answer in a second. I think there is a different strata of work that can solve that problem. First of all, on the front lines of doing the research, obviously producing evidence that is compelling and persuasive about ways to markedly improve health outcomes. Examples like the ones Dr. Tobin just showed, where you can see very tangibly how this kind of work has led to improved health outcomes, can be very persuasive in itself. But the research community, and the PBRNs among them, need to do a better job of enlightening policymakers who make these resource allocations and determine how much money goes to NIH institutes and ARC and so forth to better understand the nature of the problem. The fact that developing these new treatments that are the more sexy breakthroughs that appear in the news doesn't actually improve anybody's health unless they actually get used. But there may not be a public awareness that there are gaps in receiving that care and how large they are. So doing a better job of enlightening policymakers about the seriousness of the problem, I think, would help draw more attention and potentially more resources to this kind of work. Jonathan, do you have more to add?
I'll echo that and maybe a slight variant on it. So for those of you who have been considering applying to PCORI, Patient-Centered Outcomes Research Institute, or have or are part of PCORI grants, you'll recognize that the important word to PCORI is stakeholder engagement, the important concept. And that what that really means is that the stakeholders, the ultimate consumers, which often include not only patients, but it could be regulatory decision makers, it could be insurance companies, need to be part of the design of studies. I think we tend to make the assumption we'll design the best studies that we and our colleagues can think of together and can carry out. We'll publish the papers and everybody will read them and say, of course, we should do it this way and that will be it. I think the alternative says that those stakeholders should be part of the discussion early on and need to be part of the study through and through. And I'll give a concrete example. When we came back to our clinical directors at the end of the first PCM study, where we had really profound increases in colon cancer screening rates that had not been reported previously in a uninsured and a publicly insured low-income population, we sort of had a surprise and a shock because we thought everybody would be excited about it and say, okay, we're going to continue this ourselves. And what they essentially said to us is, this is great, but we simply don't have the resources to hire the patient navigators and the care managers that were so critical to the success of this intervention. So we had to think about who might have those resources and realize this to be sustainable couldn't be just a matter of writing one grant after another. So we engaged some partners, medical directors at managed care organizations, to see whether we could come up with an alignment of interest. So the good news was we found some willing partners and conducted the next two studies that I shared with you. But it came at a cost of excluding uninsured patients and excluding higher proportions of Spanish-speaking patients in the subsequent studies because they were uninsured. So having had the stakeholders in initially might have had us design the studies a little bit differently and involve a different group of stakeholders that would help to ensure its implementation.
I want to build on that excellent point and also address a question I see from Mary in the chat box, and that is that the engagement of stakeholders is not only important for the excellent reasons that Dr. Tobin noted, but also in framing a research intervention that actually has the prospect of making a big difference, it's very helpful to get input from the people on the ground who understand the barriers the best. So some of the most effective health services research interventions that have really moved the needle on health outcomes have come from insights from practitioners on the front lines, patients, parents, depending on the nature of the topic that we're talking about. who can suggest, if you really want to see an improvement in how often my child can use an inhaler for her asthma, or for the primary care clinician to say, the thing I really need to know to improve my management of patients with diabetes is X, Y, or Z, then you can design practice-based research aimed around that particular barrier, which has already been identified as the major obstacle, and you have much better prospects of producing research that can really dramatically improve outcomes. So I think one of the first steps for somebody who's starting out in doing practice-based research around a particular health topic is to have that conversation with stakeholders to understand what the implementation barriers are, so that your implementation science work can be correctly oriented to those challenges.
Great. We have a number of questions in the chat box. Why don't we take these as in the order that they were entered into the chat box. First, Ann Gagliotti is asking about what number of uninsured patients were in the New York City screening program, and is there a mechanism to finance colonoscopy for these patients?
So New York City's health commissioner, prior health commissioner, actually two, so who is now the head of the CDC, Dr. Tom Frieden, took the position that colonoscopy is the best way to determine presence of colorectal cancer, and therefore every New Yorker should have access to the best option. And so to that end, there is a large public system in New York, formerly called the Health and Hospitals Corporation, now called Health and Hospitals, that has a number of both ambulatory care sites, some of which are now part of an FQHC network, and a number of inpatient facilities that all offer colonoscopy. And so it was very important to Dr. Frieden and to the New York City Health Department to make sure that any New Yorker who wanted to have a colonoscopy could. In our initial PCM1 project and in the subsequent projects, we took the approach that's been advanced by Dr. Sidney Winnower here at Memorial Sloan Kettering that says, in brief, the best screening method for colorectal cancer is the one that gets done. And so for many FQHCs, that increase in colon cancer screening in PCM1 took the form of FOBTs and more recently FITs. And so we at CDN are agnostic to that, although we understand that New York City has a preference for colonoscopy. And so we go with Dr. Winnower's approach. And so part of the interaction with the care manager is to determine, is a patient willing to undergo PrEP to have a colonoscopy? And provisions are made through a program in the city for low-cost screening colonoscopies for uninsured patients. And, of course, Medicaid will cover at age 50 and above a screening colonoscopy. So I think each practice has to decide what is its preferred approach, but has to be flexible on making the wide range of different effective screening modalities available. And as Dr. Woolf mentioned, there may be new technologies, pill cameras, there are virtual colonoscopies under development, there are some new immunohistochemical tests. So I think the numbers of types of tests will increase, and our strategy has to be deciding with the patient what's the best test for them at that time and helping them to get the best test available for their needs.
Great. We have another question about the studies that you talked about, Dr. Tobin. Andrew Hunt is asking, can you comment on the number of full-time personnel it took to coordinate the studies and the leadership structure of the research group?
So there were a PI and co-PI, Dr. Alan Dietrich from Dartmouth. Geisel School of Medicine at Dartmouth has been the PI of the three projects, and I served as the co-PI. There were two half-time project directors, one at Dartmouth, who was primarily responsible for evaluation and data collection, data management oversight, and then a project manager here at CDN halftime who is responsible for implementation activities. And so that's the way we divided. And then we had each of the care managers covered somewhere between 2 and 3 sites, depending on where the sites were in terms of their enrollment period. I put a URL to a PubMed link to our timing paper, which goes into extensive studies. But over 18 months, the short answer is that it took about 248 over 18 months in order to help a woman to complete her screening. And so if you turn that into an encounter, it's about 15 minutes of time in those actual phone calls. Some calls lasted longer, some were shorter, but that was the cumulative amount of time over a year and a half that it took in order to help complete their breast, cervical, and colorectal cancer screening services.
Okay, great. And I want to encourage the fellows, if you have follow-up questions, just jump into the conversation by unmuting your phone. And Tamer Seed has a question. Did you see similar effects on other screening methods, such as hemocult stool cards?
Right. So I think I mentioned that we did see in the first study a higher increase due to uptake of hemocult cards. And then we took the position the best test is whichever gets done. And so it was really driven by a combination of patient preference or by site availability or convenience for referral for colonoscopies. But we did see increases across all of the types of services, and the cumulative effect is the effect size that I reported.
Great. Mary Delansky says, thank you for sharing this impressive study. Did you do any comparisons on which implementation strategies worked better than others? And it seems like cost would be an important variable to capture.
Right. So this was a two-arm study that compared a multi-component intervention that we refer to as prevention care management against usual care. And I'll just flip back a few slides. So one of the challenges in practice-based research and in implementation, dissemination and implementation research is if we were to design the optimal study, it would be a series of factorial studies of different components. But in care settings like busy federally qualified health centers, busy primary care practices, that's not the way care is delivered, and it is virtually always multi-component. So up on the screen are the different components of the intervention. We do have some qualitative sense from patient feedback that the discussions with the clinicians were the most important driver, and the reminders and the scheduling were the most important facilitators. We do have another paper that I'll share on barriers and facilitators, but unfortunately, again, the way we designed this study, it was a shotgun approach compared to usual care, which does have some lower intensity versions of these projects, but we couldn't really say which piece was the most effective ingredient. Think of this as a multivitamin.
That's great. Well, it really is impressive, particularly given the patient population that you guys were working with, the results you were able to get. Annie Agliotti has another question. Can you speak about how other paradigms like complexity science and complex systems might be helpful in T2 research?
So, Steve, do you want me to speak to that, or would you?
Why don't you start out about the link that you circulated, and then I'll make additional comments.
Sure. So it's a great question, and it's really an important burgeoning field that I think brings not only observational and experimental methods, but brings a set of methods that I'm still learning that have to do with simulation. So I think there really are a variety of important methods that can be brought to bear on complexity science. For those who are interested in that question, I shared a link that was moderated by a director at the OBSSR, Office of Behavioral and Social Science Research at NIH, Dr. Patty Mabry. She's at Indiana University, so the listserv is now facilitated there, but you can actually scroll through really a very rich, and I, for those who are interested in complexity, I would suggest them signing up for that listserv, because it often brings to my attention publications that are in journals that I don't routinely read, and workshops and sessions that aren't there. I'll also post a link in a few moments to a session that we did with Dr. Mabry on complexity science having to do with tobacco control. So I think it really does bring a lot of new insights and important methodologies. It's not one that I personally have had any great experience with.
And what I would add is there's a lot of emphasis, you know, or an increasing amount of emphasis on complexity theory. I would commend the writings of Kurt Stange, who's been increasingly interested in how this plays out in family medicine. But the other aspect of the question that I think people should think about as they plan out their careers is the role of big data. So we are living in a world that increasingly allows us access to very large data sets. Practice-based research has an opportunity to find its way in that space. But much of the interest in the health field around big data is how to harness that information through complex systems modeling, predictive analytics, agent-based modeling, and other similar techniques, network analysis, to try to understand causal models and to actually attempt to predict outcomes for scenarios that are too complex to actually study in a randomized controlled trial. So this is a possibility that came into existence because of the convergence not only of these large data sets, but also of supercomputers and greater computing capacity than existed earlier in my career. So that opportunity, for example, in merging EMR data with administrative data and GIS mapping of where patients live, allows for practice-based research to enter a new phase that I think would be could potentially be very impactful.
Oh, really interesting. Mary Delansky asks, as new investigators in this area of science, what is the first step for us?
Well, that was actually the question I was teeing off from earlier about whatever your field is, to sit down with the stakeholders and folks on the front line to have some exploratory discussions about the barriers they face in closing the gap in the quality of care, and use that as a framework for defining the most important questions that research can answer to improve outcomes. I also typically encourage my mentees to think about their areas of passion, what they really enjoy, and finding the intersection between the research topics you love and the ones that are most likely to make a big impact on patients' health is the sweet spot for getting started.
So I would add two comments to that. One is a deliberative process of you have to start with the things that interest you most. And then the second is, but these things have to be in your environment. So I think my recommendation to mentees and students is try to reconcile the things that you are excited and passionate about, thinking about and reading about, with the people and opportunities in your environment for really trying to give yourself that initial opportunity to see how research is done, to contribute, and hopefully to have the opportunity to add not only your insight but your questions to the research enterprise. So I think it's balancing what you'd like to do with what you can do given the resources and the expertise in the programs where you're working and the leadership and the mentorship that you have access to, and try to harmonize those two to help you develop. It doesn't mean that that's what you'll be doing forever, but it means it'll build in the near term your expertise and your competence in areas that you will have access to.
That's an excellent point. And I would add that it's helpful is to try to leverage resources that are around you that may not be in your academic department or your clinic. Many of us who do practice-based research find ourselves in a lonely setting where there aren't always immediate collaborators nearby. But it's the kind of research that benefits from interdisciplinary collaborations. So finding like-minded investigators who maybe don't have your same clinical background but have expertise in research methods that would augment your work, or seasoned investigators who can apply methods and share methods that would help facilitate your research, allows for you to leverage the skills and resources they bring to the table, and also allows for your work to be richer by harnessing, say, social sciences, modeling techniques, and other tools for your research that might not be possible if you stay inside your silo.
That's an excellent point. Min Yang asks, as primary care physicians, what advantages do we have in doing comparative effectiveness studies as compared to specialists? How can we best position ourselves? I feel most of our research is focused on preventive services or care delivery methods rather than therapeutic measures.
It's an interesting question because there's actually a series of questions nested inside that. I think the answer is, in general, that there's lots of opportunity for comparative research that is possible from a primary care platform, but I wouldn't limit it to comparative effectiveness research. So, for example, one of the more fundamental areas worth documenting is how the epidemiology or the case mix, if you will, differs between the kinds of patients who are seen in primary care for the same health problem that specialists treat, because the case mix for the specialist is a referral population. So what is the actual prevalence of a particular problem for patients who have a chief complaint presenting to a primary care physician versus those presenting to an oncologist? Obviously, the epidemiology differs, but the data on that is often very limited. Descriptive data on care delivery patterns in primary care versus specialty practices is often not available. The treatment effectiveness as opposed to the efficacy when studies have been performed by specialists in controlled settings and trying to determine how well that intervention works in terms of its effectiveness in normal practice settings is something that primary care can readily contribute to. But the other area that I think is potentially powerful for our area of research is to compare the prudence, if you will, of care delivery patterns. So, for example, we did a study a few years ago looking at follow-up to colonoscopy biopsies and the extent to which gastroenterologists adhered to practice guidelines on how often the follow-up colonoscopy should occur. And we were able to demonstrate that the specialists had poor adherence to practice guidelines and engaged in much more over-screening and over-testing than did primary care physicians. So in the context of the Choose Wisely campaign that's spreading across the country, where more attention is being given to limiting the use of tests or treatments that have potential harms and demonstrating more prudence in the care delivery patterns, being able to document how primary care physicians differ from specialists in that respect can also be helpful.
So I'll add 2 points to that insight. I completely agree. If we go back to Vladimir, could you put slide 27 back up, the ecology of medical care? I think that question is in part answered by the fact that most of the care is not seen in academic settings and not necessarily seen in a specialist's office. 113 of those visits are to a primary care clinician, and So my thinking is that you've chosen to be in a primary care setting, and all the questions that you could potentially want to ask exist in primary care. And I'll give a second example from my own career. So my early work was in, I'm a cardiovascular epidemiologist by training, and my first real study, NIH-funded study, was looking at the utilization of cardiovascular nuclear medicine scans as a technology to spare people undergoing cardiac catheterization and bypass surgery. This predated the appearance of angioplasty. And it was clear that in addition to the technology being important, there were patient factors. And we published what I think was the first paper to document a very significant gender disparity. We couldn't comment on an ethnic disparity because relatively few non-white patients had either the nuclear scan or more invasive cardiovascular diagnostics in this Bronx, New York-based, hospital-based practice, where, in fact, the ethnicity of the neighborhood is largely African-American, but the users of the specialty care settings were not. So we learned a lot and learned a lot about symptoms, but realized that the answer to the question we were most interested in, which is how do people wind up in the nuclear cardiology or in the cath lab, really can't be addressed by walking in and studying in a cardiologist's office or in a cath lab or in the nuclear cardiology setting. And we had to go upstream to primary care settings. We had to see what happens in the general internist and the family medicine physician's office when a patient presents with fatigue or with chest pain or with elevated risk for cardiovascular disease. So while I think it's important to look in both settings to really understand how patients eventually wind up in nuclear cardiology, in cath labs, and in bypass and angioplasty suites, we really have to move that upstream into primary care, where it really is a complex issue, where it's an interplay between symptoms, perception of risk, anxiety on the part of the patient, anxiety on the part of the physician, and the willingness to tolerate ambiguity. And so I think there's a whole world of important questions. That's not to diminish the importance. I still do that work in the specialty care setting and continue to look at how cardiovascular imaging technology has emerged and evolved. But I think the real questions and the real important questions happen in primary care, where most people get most of their care most of the time.
And I want to, again, build off of what Jonathan said, to add that there are areas of research that can only be done in that setting and are very difficult to perform in the specialty setting. Examples include understanding continuity relationships, longitudinal care. Is often very difficult in specialty settings that by their very nature swoop in on the patient for limited periods of time or for episodic events. Another example is complex, the management of multiple complex chronic diseases. Most specialty research is organ-specific and categorical, but primary care has the challenge of dealing with competing demands, prioritization, looking at synergies and intersections between multiple chronic conditions and so forth. And then the whole notion of the patient-clinician relationship, communication, shared decision-making. Not that specialists don't also have interest in this and apply the learnings that come from such research, but there is a different dynamic that exists in a continuity relationship that really can't be studied in specialty settings. So there are more examples than that, but there is a terrain for research that really can't be done outside of the primary care environment.
Great. Mary Delansky says, thank you for the helpful links, Dr. Tobin. And I just want to point out to the fellows that Dr. Tobin's provided several links in the chat box that you might want to check out that are related to the discussion today. She asks, you talked about the confusion with terms in this area. Can you comment on quality improvement science, as this seems like a new term? QI seemed more operational and context specific.
Sure. So I think there's a distinction that needs to be drawn between quality improvement, which is a practice that takes place, and quality improvement research, which is the development of methods, of new methods for both implementing quality improvement and for evaluating its effectiveness. And so I think that that distinction, for some people, the critical distinction is which am I doing right now, and for most people, what they're doing is quality improvement. But what I'm suggesting is that we're really at a point in history where this should be seen as a continuum. And if we think about that spectrum of translational research that Dr. Woolf shared, the blue highways, that there are interfaces between each of the T's that provide opportunity for handoff. And handoffs are the places that the greatest successes happen and the greatest failures. The evidence suggests that many medical errors happen at those handoffs. And so what I'm suggesting is that we should be looking more specifically at the opportunity to build more robust methods that take us from the T3 science into implementation and into quality improvement. And my thinking on that is that our quality improvement measures are the models of sustainability. They're what helps us document that we've made these advances, and that they also help us document that we are continuing to support these advances. So that's the continuum that I think is important, and I think quality improvement science or quality improvement research as opposed to quality improvement are the places that we can try to build that new infrastructure and new understanding.
Agreed. It's important for new investigators to also understand in the distinction between quality improvement and quality improvement research that IRBs treat this very differently. So if you're doing an activity that can be characterized as quality improvement, that doesn't need to be submitted to an IRB. When you're doing research, you do need IRB approval. And the distinction between those, simplifying what is actually a little more complex topic, but the distinction between those is whether you're producing generalizable knowledge from the quality improvement activities. But the other point I would make is that this quality improvement term is not a new term. It's been around for decades. And this notion that between quality improvement science and quality improvement activities has methodologic implications, because many of the techniques that are used in quality improvement, especially ones drawn from the business world, don't fit neatly into the traditional study designs that we use in health research. They don't fall well into randomized controlled trials. A classic example of this is the PDSA cycles that became popularized by IHI, the Institute for Healthcare Improvement, and ultimately, or originally came from the business world, are by their very nature evolving and dynamic interventions that change over time. And your typical NIH study section doesn't look well on interventions that are not consistent over the course of the entire study period. Whereas in the business community and people doing quality improvement in the healthcare setting often go by the adage that you want to fail and fail quickly so that you rapidly identify better strategies. That often runs against the traditional thinking of study sections at NIH about the fidelity of an intervention over time. That's changing. More modern thinking about study designs is entering the field, and there is greater openness, especially with funders like PCORI, to adapting interventions and pragmatic trials that allow for that kind of flexibility. But that distinction between the quality improvement world and research activities is very relevant.
Okay, Ann Gagliotti has a comment. Our research group here at Morehouse has forged a partnership with Georgia Tech School of Industrial Systems and Engineering. Translation of that is that they're modeling wizards at Georgia Tech. This has allowed us to ask and answer questions using methods that we would not otherwise have available to us. And if you would like, feel free to unmute your phone and comment further. Okay. Doctors Tobin and Woolf, do you have any reaction to that comment?
Well, I agree completely with it. And when I mentioned earlier the idea of forming partnerships with colleagues in other fields, especially if you're in a lonely setting where you don't have collaborators in your own specialty, this is a good example. In our case in Virginia, we're forming a partnership with data scientists at the Virginia Tech Social and Decision Analytics Laboratory for some of the research that we want to do. We find it very intellectually stimulating to learn from colleagues who have backgrounds in other areas. And it does give you collaborators who may not be available on your campus or in your in the hallways of your department.
Yeah, and I think it real breakthroughs come from the interface. If you think about evolution and genetic diversity, when diversity is introduced, oftentimes the result of that diversity produces novel species, novel breakthroughs, and the same, I think, is true in the history and sociology of science and medicine. And so I think at our own peril, we read the same journals that everybody else reads and go to the same meetings. So the best recommendation is try to get outside of your comfort zone from time to time. Try to go to meetings that introduce you to concepts that are completely foreign, and talk to colleagues about what their interests are, and see where you have mutuality of interest. We've had some great experience also with Georgia Tech, and there's some remarkable information science scholars there that I think have a lot to offer ways of thinking, and certainly the methods that I've learned from them about participatory design of applications of internet, web-based, and smartphone-based applications in some of the NIH-funded and PCORI-funded studies we're doing has been remarkable, but there's been an incredible synergy because it looks like a variety of community-based participatory research, but done in a highly technical setting. So try to get outside of your usual social and professional circles every chance you can.
That's great advice. Alex has a question. He greatly appreciated the example of the FQHCs telling you that there weren't the resources to continue the preventive care manager model. What advice might you have for making T2 research interesting to integrated health systems when the payment models don't necessarily support higher payment for better care, parentheses, yet? Can you talk more about your experience going to payers?
Sure. So I just put up the two links to those studies, which will give you a little bit of a flavor of some of the background of how that those partnerships came together. But in brief, I'll sort of give you the takeaway message. We went to talk with them. We had a series of focus groups with medical directors from managed care organizations and met with the director of the Office of Medicaid Managed Care at our state health department. And one thing that we learned was that the managed care organizations had have a quality improvement and research requirement to participate on an annual basis. And this was a challenge and sometimes a burden to many of the managed care organizations. And so one of the questions we posed to the organizations and to the health department was, could participating in this clinical trial meet some or all of their research and QI requirements for a year, or for 2 years, or 3 years? And we were really delighted with the open reception that we received from both the state and from the managed care organizations. And so we found a way, while it didn't necessarily put money in their pocket in the form of either better patient care, better outcomes, or more savings, it did put money in their pocket in the sense that they now had access to a research team of health service researchers, epidemiologists, biostatisticians in an academic medical center, Dartmouth, and a practice-based research network, CDN. It had the imprimatur of National Cancer Institute funding.
and it served the needs of that organization for several cycles of their annual quality improvement project. So part of it was looking for a win-win situation, and it may not be the primary aim of your study or the primary aim of their activities, but again, sitting and talking, we can find common ground and then hopefully find a way that they will derive benefit from the enterprise itself.
Okay, great. Amanda Ross reminds us that the links that have been provided by Dr. Tobin are now housed on course sites for reference by all the fellows and mentors if they wish to access them. Liz Waddell has a question. The IRB issue has been a challenge for me as we start to add on evaluation components to projects that started out as simple quality improvement. Our IRB at OHSU has required that we get approvals for qualitative interviews with clinic staff. Do you have any comments or suggestions about dealing with these IRB challenges, Dr. Tobin or Dr. Woolf?
Well, again, if the interviews are being done strictly for quality improvement purposes, it shouldn't be an IRB issue. If, however, your intent, for example, is to do, to obtain interviews, recordings and transcript analysis, to do coding of it, and to publish the results of the interviews, then that does now constitute research. So it does depend on the goals you have in mind. IRBs are a really thorny problem, and one suggestion I would have to investigators who are going to be at their institution for a while and are dealing with IRBs that may not be as enlightened as others about this kind of work is to take some time to meet with the IRB officials. We have found that very effective at our institution, as have colleagues elsewhere, to bring them along with understanding the nature of the research that you do, because it doesn't look like a typical clinical trial that they're used to reviewing. And sometimes their attitudes about approving these projects may change over time.
I think that's a great point. And in the era of big data, when a researcher or a quality committee can actually request an identical query, that distinction, I think, is going to get further blurred. I'm pulling up PubMed search to the work of Nancy Cass, and along with Faden, Tunis, and several others, a short list of papers that I think would be helpful reading to try to frame the approach and frame a response to your own institution's thinking about when is it quality improvement, when is it quality improvement research, and when is it research. It's always safest to submit something to an IRB and let the IRB determine that it is exempt or that it requires limited review, maybe expedited review. Under the OHRP, the investigator really shouldn't be making that determination. And so I tend to be more conservative and also interested in preserving the option to disseminate our results through publications and presentations. So I have on multiple occasions taken a quality improvement project to one or more IRBs and asked for a review. Sometimes they will exempt it, and other times they'll approve the research component of it and remove from the application the standard QI. But Dr. Woolf mentioned with the advent of big data, I think that distinction is going to become further blurred, and so I tend to recommend going to the IRB, disclosing that you may think about publishing the results of this, even if it is a limited QI question, but you're out to learn something generalizable from that. So that would be my recommendation.
Excellent. Well, I think we're out of time. This has been a fantastic webinar. Thank you both so much for taking the time to prepare and present to our fellows. If we could, we would give you a standing ovation. This has been wonderful. And I think the questions could continue on for some time. So thank you, Dr. Tobin and Dr. Woolf.
So I want to
Sure, thank you. I just want to remind everybody that our next webinar will be on March 17th. That will be led by Chet Fox and Mary Delansky. And appropriate to the last question, it will be on quality improvement research and practice improvement. So we will see you all then. And everyone have a good day. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Thank you.